Hello everybody, in this video lecture we will cover joints of the body. This is chapter 8, part 1. So articulation is site where two or more bone meet. So bone is actually never connected to another bone without some structure in between them. Right, so we don't have direct connection, one bone to another bone. There is always something in between. It can be membrane, it can be cartilage, right? And where two bone comes together, that's what we call articulation. So function of joints is give skeleton mobility and hold skeleton together. So based on amount of movement allowed by the joint, joint can be classified into three functional groups. So we use functional classification for joints, and when we classify them based on amount of movement, we call them immovable or thin arthrosis, slightly movable amphiarthrosis, and freely movable diarthrosis. So arthrosis over here, arthrosis, that's the articulation. This is a joint. And then thin, amphi, and di tell us either it's not movable or slightly or freely movable, right? Thin means come together. Amphi, it's like amphibia. So it's here and there, right? It's not completely movable. And di means two bones together move freely. So here you can see example of the thin arthrosis, immovable joint. That's what connects cranial bones together. We call it suture. We can see slightly movable amphiarthrosis, intervertebral joint. Or we can see this one, that's the hip joint. This is diarthrosis, that's synovial joint. But we also can classify joints not based on their mobility, but based on the material that holds bone together. So we can have structural classification. So the one we just discussed was functional classification. This one is structural classification. So it can be either fibrous joint, cartilaginous, or synovial, right? So here on your right, you can see structural and functional classification of joints, structural, fibrous, cartilaginous, synovial, and functional thin arthrosis, amphiarthrosis, and diarthrosis. So here's a summary of joint classification. So you can see fibrous, cartilaginous, and synovial. That's our structural classes. And here our functional classification. Either it's movable, slightly movable, or freely movable. Right? So, and we will look at different types during this lecture. So we're going to start with fibrous joints. And bones joined by the dense fibrous connective tissue. There is no any joint cavity, and most of them are thin arthrotic, so immovable. Three types of fibrous joint include sutures, syndesmosis, and gomphosis. So fibrous joints, sutures. Sutures are rigid interlocking joints containing short connective tissue fibers. Sutures found only in the skull, and they not movable, right? So it's thin arthrosis. They allow for growth during youth, and in the middle age, sutures ossify, and now they call synostosis. So again, if you look at this word, it seems like, oh my goodness, it's like new language, but syn means come together, and ostosis means bones, so two bones come together. So the sutures are actually those are very small connective tissue fibers. So if I will do it over here, that would be the suture, right? So that's very short connective tissue fibers, and this is what makes the sutures of the skull, only found in the skull. Okay, let me pick up my pointer. Now, fibrous joints, syndesmosis. Bones connected by ligaments, bands of fibrous tissue. Well, so if sutures was kind of like very short fibrous joint, right? Then syndesmosis, we just have a longer. So that's pretty much will be the difference. So like this one over here. So you can see collagen fibers that are longer than sutures. So bones are connected by ligaments. Movement varies from immovable to slightly movable. An example will be this distal tibia fibula joint. It's synarthrotic, so non-movable, and diarthrotic. Interosseous membrane between radius and ulna is another example. It would be kind of like a membrane between two bones. The last type of fibrous joint is gomphosis. And gomphosis also very rare, the same as sutures. So sutures only in the skull. Gomphosis is the joint between teeth and sockets, alveolar sockets. So here's the alveolar socket in a maxilla or mandible, and tooth fits inside the socket, and there is like ligament over here connecting tooth to the bone. It's called periodontal ligament. And this is a type of gomphosis, right? That's a gomphosis fibrous joint. Next group of joints based on a structural classification is cartilaginous joint. Well, then bones united by cartilage, right? And no joint cavity either, the same as in the fibrous joints. Two types, synchondrosis and symphysis. So synchondrosis, we have cartilage. We have cartilages in both types, right? Because it's cartilaginous joints. What type of cartilage? That's what different. Synchondrosis, it's a hyaline cartilage. And symphysis is fibra cartilage. So this is synchondrosis. Again, syn means come together. So what comes together? Kind of like two cartilaginous parts, right? So example would be a bar or plate of hyaline cartilage that unites the bones. Even this epiphyseal plate, it's type of synchondrosis. All of them are synarthrotic. When you see this arthrotic, that means we're talking about degree of movement, and syn means no movement. No movement over here. Another example over here gonna be the joint between the sternum and the first rib. Only the first rib, right? That's immovable, and this is synchondrosis. And cartilage here is hyaline cartilage. In a symphysis, so symphysis is also cartilaginous joint, but now we have a different cartilage. Now we have fibra cartilage. So bones are united by fibra cartilages. And it might have a little bit of hyaline cartilage, like remember this intervertebral disc, right? But it still have this, you know, fibra cartilage on the surface of the disc. So example would be the intervertebral joints and pubic symphysis over here. And the strong flexible amphiarthrosis. Amphiarthrosis means slightly movable, right? Okay, and the last group of joints based on their structure are synovial joints. Synovial joints, they all diarthrotic, so they all freely movable, and include all limbs joints, most joints of the body. And you can see here on this diagram that synovial joints, we have a pivot joint, hinge, saddle, plane, chondroloid, ball and socket, right? So that's all example of synovial joints. But remember, synovial is based on their structure, right? And diarthrotic means that's freely movable. So that's based on their function or degree of movement. So what synovial joints have, right? This is their features that distinguish them from, you know, other type of joints. So first, they have articular cartilage on both bones that form a joint. It's a hyaline cartilage. Then they have a synovial cavity. That's a small potential space. Then they have articular capsule or synovial capsule. Well, articular capsule has two layers. Outer is fibrous capsule, and inner is synovial capsule, synovial membrane, right? So articular capsule, two parts, outer fibrous part and inner synovial part. Also synovial joints, they have synovial fluid. And this is a slippery filtrate of plasma and hyaluronic acid. And synovial fluid lubricates and nourishes articular cartilage. So let's look at this diagram here on your right. So here we have joint between two bones, right? Both bones are covered by articular cartilage. So right, this is articular cartilage, this is articular cartilage. And then we have a capsule, joint capsule surrounding, you know, this part of the bones, right? So that capsule has a wall made of two layers, fibrous layer, right? So here's the fibrous layer, outer layer, and synovial layer, synovial membrane, shown here in green, right? So that's the capsule. Inside this capsule, we have synovial cavity, and inside this cavity, we have synovial fluid. Now, on this side, you also can see that we have ligament, for example, right, that make it more stable, like reinforces and protects this joint, right? That's ligament over here on the top of the capsule. Okay, and there are three possible types of reinforcing the synovial joints, right? And it's three different type of ligaments. So it can be intrinsic ligament or capsular ligament. This is the part of the fibrous capsule, right? Or it can be extra capsular outside of the capsule or intracapsular deep inside the capsule, right? So when we have this synovial capsule, right? So synovial capsule has fibrous membrane and synovial membrane inside, right? And part of this fibrous membrane, that's our ligament, capsular ligament. But we might have some extra ligaments that reinforce the joint. And it can be, if it's outside of the capsule, it's extracapsular. If it's inside, then it's intracapsular. Right, let me see if I can. Okay, so let me, okay, so here's one bone, right? Here's another bone. Now what do we need? Now we need articular cartilage, right? So we need to put articular cartilage on the surface of the bone that makes this joint, right? So I put it in blue. So that's articular. Oh my goodness, that's horrible, but sorry. And then I need to draw the capsule. My goodness, where am I drawing? So here's the capsule, right? Here's the capsule. And this, what I show in yellow, this is gonna be my fibrous capsule, right? And this is the same as the intrinsic ligament. So that's my intrinsic ligament. Now inside, right, I will have synovial membrane. So here's my synovial membrane, right here. On. Now I need to add what? Now I need to add fluid. Right, so I need to add synovial fluid over here inside, right? So here I'm adding synovial fluid inside, right? Okay, well now what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna draw extracellular capsule so it can be like, let's say, part of the ligament, right? So that can be a ligament. That's extracellular. Or I can have, actually, ligament inside, maybe like this and like this. Okay, so that's also gonna be a ligament that reinforces the joint, but this will be intracapsular ligament. Okay, also another feature of synovial joints, they have rich nerve and blood supply. Okay, where's my pointer? So nerve fibers detect pain, monitor joint position and stretch, and capillary beds produce filtrate for synovial fluid. So it's very vascular, synovial joints are vascular and very richly innervated. Now another structure that reduces friction stabilize the synovial joints, and we will discuss those structure. One of them are bursae. So bursae or bursa are flattened fibrous sacs filled with synovial fluid, right? And they line with the synovial membrane. They contain synovial fluid. Commonly act as a ball bearing, where ligament, muscle, skin, tendons, or bones rub together, right? So on this diagram, you can see here the bursa, right? So it's a sac with the synovial fluid inside. And what they do, they prevent, let's say this ligament, they prevent it from damaging, especially when it slides. And if it's just rubbing on the top of the bony structure, right, it can be damaged. So that's like a little cushioning inside, right? Or it can be not bursa, but tendon sheath. So tendon sheath is similar to a bursa. It's elongated bursa that wraps completely around a tendon. So you see, this is the tendon of the biceps brachii muscle, and there is like a, this, you know, structure that wraps around it. That's the tendon sheath. And it's similar in structure to the bursa because it also has synovial fluid inside, right? And all this does, it protects the ligaments, it protects the muscle, protects the skin from this friction, from rubbing on the hard surfaces, and from tearing, from damaging of this structure. Stabilizing factors at synovial joints. So shape of articular surfaces, ligament number and location, and muscle tone, right? That's what make our synovial joints stable. So depends on the shape, it can be more or less stable. Depends on the number of ligaments and their location, again, it can be more or less stable. And muscle tone play big role in the stabilizing of synovial joints, especially important in reinforcing shoulder and knee joint and arches of the foot. Synovial joints movement. So muscle attaches across a joint, right? So there is no point for muscle to have insertion and origin and insertion on the same bone, because the function of your muscle to move your bones. So it need to be, the muscle need to be attached across a joint. So at the joint, at synovial joint, we can make this movement. So muscles, they have origin, and origin is attachment to the immovable bone, and insertion is attachment to the movable bone. So muscle contraction always causes insertion to be pulled towards the origin. So insertion always goes towards the origin. And those movements can be along different planes. It can be along transverse plane, frontal, sagittal plane. So range of movement. We can have a sliping movement, so it's non-axial. Kind of you can say that there is no change in an angle between bones. I'll show it to you in a minute. Uniaxial movement in one plane, biaxial movement in two planes, and multiaxial movement in or around all three planes. So synovial joints can be divided into six types based on the shape of articular surfaces. It can be plane, hinge, pivot, chondroloid, saddle, and ball and socket. Okay, so we're gonna start with plane joints. Plane joints are non-axial joints. Flat articular surfaces and short gliding movement. So here on the diagram below, you can see we have two bones that come together forming a joint, and they just slightly glide across each other. Example of a plane joint would be intercarpal joint, so joint between carpal bones. And I told you that I will explain you what does it mean non-axial. If you look at these two bones, the angle between these two bones are never changing, right? It's like if you would have your book on your desk and you just slide your book a little bit along the desk. So hinge joints, uniaxial joint, similar to the hinge of your door that allow you only two movements, right? Open the door, close the door. The same on your body, hinge joint allow you only flexion and extension, and it's a motion along a single plane. Example of hinge joint would be elbow joint. So you can do your elbow flexion and elbow extension. Pivot joints. Pivot joint, when we have rounded end of one bone and it conforms to a sleeve or ring of another bone. It's uniaxial movement as well. So example would be radial ulna joint. So radius has this rounded end and it fits in a radial notch of the ulna. We also have this ligament that reinforces this joint and it's allow uniaxial movement, and this is vertical axis. Chondroloid joint. It's biaxial joint. Both articular surfaces are oval, permit all angular movements. Example would be metacarpophalangeal joint. Joint between your fingers and your metacarpals. Right, so that gives you more freedom of movement in two planes. Saddle joint. Saddle joint is also biaxial, so we're moving into two planes, but it gives us greater freedom than the ones that we just discussed. Chondroloid joint. So each articular surface has both concave and convex area. An example of saddle joint would be as a joint of the thumb, carpometacarpal joint of the thumb. Ball and socket joint are multi-axial joint. This is most freely movable synovial joint, and it will include a ball, the rounded structure of one bone, and a socket of the another bone. An example would be shoulder joint. And if you look at the shoulder joint, you can see that the socket is very narrow, and it allows a huge degree of movement, free movement over here. But because the socket is so shallow, it's actually very unstable joint. That's why it needs to be reinforced by lots of ligaments over here and tendons. So we get movement, we increase the degree of movement, and we decrease the stability of a joint. And as another example of ball and socket joint would be your hip joint, and this is between the acetabulum of a hip bone and femur. But the difference is, in the hip joint, the socket is very deep. That's why it's less movable than shoulder joint, but more stable. And of course, you need more stability in your hip joint than you need in your shoulder. So next several slides, you have all joints that we have in the body, including their names, their structural characteristics, their functional functional characteristic, and bones that form this joint. So please pause this video and read all this information, or just refer to a regular PowerPoint. You also can find this table in your textbook. So that's show you a skull, vertebral column, and ribs. On this slide, you see the joint between the sternum and ribs. Over here, you see the joint of the pectoral girdle and upper extremities. And the last slide shows you the joint of your pelvic girdle and lower extremities. So again, pause the video, take time to read names of those joints and their function, their structure. Also in Canvas, you will find video that was recorded by very talented, very nice guy. I think he teaching art. So if people wanna draw a human body, they need to know structure of the joints and how they work and what movement they allow. So I posted this video on Canvas. You can find it, and please watch it because it's very helpful. Okay, so that's it for this video, and I will be recording the second part of the chapter. Thank you for watching, and hope it was helpful.